This is a day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Glad that you're joining us online for worship here at CUP Evangelical Presbyterian Church. Just a couple of announcements to share with you before we get started. First of all, we are glad that you're joining us in this first ever online service. We do ask that you consider giving online as well through Tithely, and you can find that on the church website. And of course, there's still the United States Postal Service. You can send in your offerings as well. We continue to pray for all of you. If there are prayer needs or concerns that you have, please continue to call the church office and reach out to us, and we are wanting to reach out to you as well. Again, we're thrilled that you're with us for worship, and let us praise the Lord together.
Please join me in the call to worship. Holy and loving God, we come to you with hopes and fears, convictions and doubts, pain and joy. By your Spirit, help us to see all things in the light of your word, our Lord Jesus Christ. By your Spirit, help us to pray honestly, to listen attentively, and grow in the grace and knowledge of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, we are ready to worship you.
Our song shall rise. These are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sore, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's here of Jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes. Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white in your world, and we are the laborers in your vineyard, declare.
Keep my eyes above the waves, where the ocean.
Of this world that power and influence are found in politicians, bankers, and celebrities, and that may be true to an extent. Yet over the past few weeks, we've seen how little power they or anyone else may have when crisis comes. Scripture tells us the power and influence that truly matter are found in the higher throne of our Heavenly Father. Yet we're often unwilling to really trust the Lord in times like these, and our lives may reflect that confusion. Please join with me in our morning prayer of confession. God of everlasting love, we confess that we have been unfaithful to our covenant with you and with each other. We have worshiped other gods, money, power, greed, and convenience. As these things have been taken away from us, we have been tempted to think that you have abandoned us yourself and neglect to love you or love our neighbor or even ourselves as you command. Forgive us, gracious God, and bring us back into the fullness of our covenant with you and with each other. We lift this plea up in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Please join me for a brief moment for silent confession. Amen. Friends, hear the good news. Jesus Christ is the Messiah, the living God, our heavenly bridegroom, and he has come to deliver us from sin, from death, and from hell. The scripture tells us, if God is for us, who can be against us? If his only Son has been given up on our behalf, how will he not give us everything else we need? For if we confess our sin, the Lord is faithful and will forgive our sin and cleanse us from unrighteousness. Friends, believe the good news. Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Let us together say what we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Thank you.
Well, good morning. Before we enter into our text out of the Gospel of John, I do want to take a moment to thank Pathway Church for their hospitality in hosting us on our first online service. We have faced a lot of brand new challenges, as I'm sure many of you had in a lot of ways over these last couple of weeks. And we wanted this service at least to be in the hands of some folks who had experience in getting us off the ground with this. So we're very grateful to the pastoral staff at Pathway and many of the helpers that have made this a very enjoyable experience, and we're thankful to be partners with them in the body of Christ. Our scripture text for this morning comes out of the 10th chapter of the Gospel of John. We are continuing our journey looking at the I am statements of Jesus as he shows who he is as God and what it means for him to be God in the flesh on earth. Last week, we looked at the passage immediately preceding this where Jesus described himself as the gate, where the past is closed off and there's protection, and he welcomes us into verdant and beautiful pastures as we experience him as the gate of salvation. Well, he elaborates on this, picking up a related image, but different and probably more famous. Here in verse 11, Jesus says, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd, who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them." He flees because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life, that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father. Verse 27, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life. They will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. I and the Father are one. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. Gracious God, as we consider your word this morning, we pray that you would speak not just to our ears, not just to our minds, but also to our hearts. Help us to experience your presence, and help us to trust you, to obey you, and to enjoy you as our good shepherd. In your wonderful name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Hundreds of years ago, when they were making maps, and yet the earth had not been completely explored, when they got to a place typically in the ocean or actually in the far western plains before Lewis and Clark explored Montana and beyond, Thomas Jefferson seriously thought they might find one of the lost tribes of Israel out there. They just had no idea what was out there. So when a map maker was just guessing, he would simply say, here there be dragons. There could be danger. There definitely was the unknown. And friends, I feel like here we are in the year 2020, and we are back coming ever closer to those points on the map, here there be dragons. We just don't know what the next day is going to bring. It's a bit like that old 70s album cover from the group Kansas, where you have that big clipper ship on the edge of the waterfall, the point of no return. Is that where we are? There's this sense of, when's the other shoe going to fall? There's this anxiety and dread that is out there. Honestly, it feels very much like a particular day, and I'll remember it like it was yesterday. I was 8 years old, and I was waiting outside for my mother to come out of a Girl Scout meeting. My sister and her good friend were in the back of our old 72 station wagon, probably older than that, actually, but I loved to get in the driver's seat and pretend like I was driving the car. So there I was doing that, and my sister's friend said, as I was playing around, hey, what does that big lever on the right do? Well, I pulled it down, and there we were, parked on the side of a hill, and the car started to go down the hill faster, faster, and faster. The thing that I will remember probably the most out of at least that side of the experience was the only time in my life I ever saw my mother run was at that moment. As she watched the car rolling down the hill, she was running as fast as her legs would carry her, desperately trying to open the driver's side door to get in to stop the vehicle, but she couldn't keep up. And so here goes the car rolling ever faster down towards South Dixie Highway, a four-lane highway at rush hour, And there we were. It's that level of anxiety that seems to be in the air that we breathe. And the only thing keeping us from the dragons that are ready to snatch us is a shepherd? What's that all about? How is Jesus being a good shepherd of all things good news for us now? It's plenty good news. We're going to take a look at the sheep. We're going to take a look at the shepherd. And we're going to take a look at the situation. Who are we as the sheep? Who is Jesus as the shepherd? And what does that mean in our current situation? Well, let's take a look at the sheep. And Jesus has a lot to say about the sheep. And some of you who were with us in the summer when we went through the 23rd Psalm will remember a little of this. But the Bible compares us to sheep an awful lot. And I think that is interesting because in our modern culture, we hate the idea of being compared to sheep. If you think about mascots for high schools or colleges, I mean, we've got tigers, we've got cougars, we've got bears, we've got lions, we've got bulldogs. That's actually the most popular mascot of all at the collegiate level. But outside of the scattering of a few rams, you know, the tough version, not a single school calls itself the lambs or the sheep. Well, it's easy to see why. Sheep are kind of not so smart, shall we say. They're pretty stubborn, and they have an annoying habit, if you're into competitive sports, of just rolling over and waiting to be killed when they get attacked. That's not so cool, but the Bible says, you know what? You are all like sheep. You go astray, you're different ways. You need a shepherd. Well, that's the thing about sheep, and this actually reminded me of the 50th anniversary of a little movie. Some of you may have seen it. It's called Bambi Meets Godzilla. And the whole movie takes about 4 minutes. 2 minutes are for the opening credits. Another minute and a half are for the closing credits. And for 30 seconds, you get a picture of Bambi kind of eating a piece of grass, looking up in this field with a little pastoral music, and then all of a sudden, Godzilla's foot. That's all there is. Sheep and Bambi are totally helpless in the midst of threats. And that's the way the Bible describes us. We cannot protect ourselves against our greatest threats. We're helpless in the face of those that would seek to destroy us. That's how Jesus sees us. That's how the Old Testament sees us. But there's more to sheep than the fact that we're helpless. Because Jesus goes on to say that as the good shepherd, he loves the sheep deeply. He says in verse 14, I am the good shepherd, I know my own, and my own know me. We looked a little bit at this last week, but there is a deep level of intimacy. A shepherd, even to this day, will name each of his sheep, and often a shepherd will know by feel which sheep in his flock he's holding, even in the dark. There's that level of knowledge, that level of intimacy. Not only does God know us by name, but we know him. Jesus says, I make myself known to you. This is not a one-way relationship. I love you, and I want you to be in communication with me as well. I love you deeply. He goes on to say in verse 29, "My Father who has given the sheep, given you if you've put yourself in Jesus' care, my Father has given you to me. The Father is greater than all." There is actually another way to translate this, and it might actually even be more accurate. What my Father has given me is greater than all, meaning the greatest gift Jesus received in his ministry on earth is us, the sheep. We pick up this idea in Ephesians chapter 1, where Paul talks about his glorious inheritance in the saints, basically meaning the only thing that Jesus didn't have before he came to earth, that he possessed when he returned, when he ascended into heaven, were those that were caught up in his train who have believed in him as Savior and Lord. As the praise song says, you didn't want heaven without us, so Lord, you brought heaven down. We are considered the glorious inheritance, the greatest gift that the Father had to give is Jesus ransoming us from sin, death, and hell. That's the level of value Jesus Christ places on us. So while we are helpless, we are also beloved. Well, let's take a closer look at the shepherd, if that's who we are as sheep. John uses a particular word in verse 11 that I absolutely love. I mean, it's typically translated as, "I am the good shepherd," but the word used there is kalos, which really more often is translated, "I am the beautiful shepherd. I am the glorious shepherd." I mean, usually when we think about Jesus in this way, the good shepherd, you know, it's very pastoral, and he's got one of the sheep up around his shoulders, and that's right, and that's true. And probably my earliest memory of who God was in my Sunday school class, and I couldn't have been more than 3 or 4. I got one of those little bright blue plastic juice cups with gold sparkles on it, and it had a little gold-stamped image of Jesus is my good shepherd. I mean, those are the very first images and memories we have of God. But for Jesus to be the glorious, beautiful shepherd means he's not just walking around with us with sunshine and moonbeams. He is there when we are faced with life and death situations. The good shepherd, the reason he comes is not just to fight off the wolf. It's to lay down his life for the sheep. Not just fight off the enemies, but even give up his life. When we think about goodness in the good shepherd, sometimes we just think of that as something that is nice. And sometimes nice is not necessarily attractive. C.S. Lewis, in his book, The Screwtape Letters, uses a line that says that this particular woman that the demonic force had really been at work on said, "She's the kind of woman who lives for others. And you can tell who the others are by their hunted look." That is not the kind of goodness that we get out of this shepherd. It is courage mixed with compassion. We're going to see a lot more of that character next week as we look at Jesus with Mary and Martha and Lazarus, as he talks about what it means to be the resurrection and the life. But all I want to say to finish up this idea for now is, when we are with Jesus Christ for eternity, we are going to find his presence interesting and compelling and joyous, not just for an hour or a day or a week, but indeed for eternity. So Jesus is not just our perfect shepherd or beautiful or glorious in the way that he is with us. He is also our lover, the lover of our souls to the point of laying down his life for us. That really is the point. You know, we tend to like our superhero movies when we see these characters with their various powers that they use to do good, but superheroes really get our attention when we find that they lay down their lives. Now, unfortunately, there are so many superhero movies that they just kind of recycle and resurrect these heroes to go back and doing the same old thing they were doing before. But in the case of Jesus Christ, his whole point of coming was to lay down his life and to enter into a whole new level of relationship, not only with us, but to allow us to enter into a whole new relationship with God the Father. We need more than protection from the shepherd. We need something called propitiation. Now, I know we're not in an era that tends to use church words all that often, but this is a very important word to know. The whole process of getting right with God involves two things. The first word is something called expiation. Something needs to be cut out, cut away. And Jesus expiates our sin. He cuts away that which is wrong in our hearts, in our lives, and he pays a blood sacrifice to remove the blood penalty that we deserve to pay. Once that expiation is done, propitiation simply means God looks at us in an entirely different way because our debt is paid. Propitiation means that we go from being enemies with God to being friends of God in a loving relationship with God. We are restored to fellowship with our Maker. So Jesus Christ saves us from the wolves that would scatter the flock, from Satan who would destroy us, by laying down his life in exchange for ours. No greater gift could anyone give than that, not to mention our very Creator, Sustainer, and indeed Redeemer. So that is how beautiful, how wonderful our Good Shepherd is. Let's think about that in terms of our current situation. Jesus says in verse 28, I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. We are in a time of the year that, at least in the EPC, we call Lent. Lent is a time where we typically pay more attention to the work of Jesus Christ leading to the cross and then the empty tomb. And I know Catholic, Lutheran, Methodist, these parts of the body of Christ, there's often been an idea of, I'm going to give something up to allow more room for God to be at work over these weeks leading up to Easter. And at least, I don't know, for me, it's usually something like, well, I'll see if I can part with chocolate for 40 days, and let's see if I can make it through and what God can do with this great sacrifice I'm making. In the past month, chocolate is the least of our worries. We have been in a situation where we're looking at significant losses of our financial resources, of our jobs, of our mobility, of getting basic items at the grocery store, and perhaps even our very health. It is unimaginable the situation we are in now compared to where we were even 6 weeks ago. I've heard this moment compared to the whole nation pulling together in ways that we haven't since the Second World War, and that may be true, but then, while the sacrifices were great, the enemy was seen as across the oceans, where now we are looking at an invisible enemy that could be anywhere. It is an extremely unsettling time. But what I have also seen in the midst of these challenges is that as we are faced with this level of loss or uncertainty, people are seeing that which they can really count on and are taking stock of that which they really desire. Okay, my retirement package isn't what I thought it was going to be. That's something that can't be counted on. But, you know, maybe I need to pick up the phone and talk to my brother, my sister, my mother, my father. I can't take some things for granted that maybe I was taking for granted before. Or maybe I need to see how my neighbor is doing. When we are faced with a crisis of this magnitude, when our world gets shaken, when our own personal lives get shaken, we begin to find what is it that truly lasts and what is perhaps not as powerful as we thought. Joni Erickson Tada has an amazing quote: God sometimes permits what he hates to accomplish what he loves. And as challenging and difficult as these days and weeks, and who knows how long this moment will last, it is possible that God is doing a work in lives across the world, not just across our country. And I pray that it is an opportunity for you to sense the presence of the Good Shepherd. In a case where many of us still have our health, it's just a matter of really taking stock of what are we going to pay attention to and invest in, to go and say, I have an opportunity to get right with God, to get right with others in my life. Much has been taken, but the best remains. God has said neither death nor life, angels nor demons, no virus, nothing can separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ, our Lord. So to finish the story of my little driving lesson bouncing down the hill, we're headed towards a four-lane highway, and somehow, there's a verse in Matthew where Jesus talks about the guardian angels of children always see the face of my Father in heaven. And whatever guardian angel I had at that moment must have really gotten the attention of our loving Father, because somehow the car hopped the sidewalk, hit the one bush in the very narrow front yards on this street, and stopped the car, flipped it up on its side, almost came back down, and my sister had fallen out of the car when the car flipped up, but the car wound up resting on its side. All four tires were, of course, destroyed, and the car itself was never really the same. I was in so much trouble, I was no longer in trouble. Because the best remained. I was alive. And my parents, of course, sat me down and talked about the evils of playing driver when your legs are too short to reach the brake. But they gave me a little extra long hug that particular night, as they did for my sister. Here's what I want to encourage you with tonight in closing. Christ is willing to die for you. That's how much he loves you. That's how much he cares about you. He is profoundly committed to you. That's why he came, to lay down his life in your place. And he has a firm grip on you. He says, "No one will snatch you out of my hands." Actually, the better translation would be, "No one is able to snatch you out of my hands. I have more power, more ability, more compassion than any force that would seek to separate you from me." Now, Leon Morris says something in closing that I think is important for us to remember. He says, what Jesus means here is, we are not saved from all earthly disaster, but we will be saved no matter what earthly disaster befalls. Friends, your good shepherd is here. He is with you, and he will save you. Put your trust in his crucified and risen hands. Let's pray. Gracious and almighty God, you know everything about us. You know our hopes, our fears, our anxieties. You know what will happen in the great unknown that lies before us. But Lord, whatever fear, whatever anxiety, whatever we are afraid to trust you with, help us to recognize that your strength, your commitment, your glory is sufficient for what we face. Lord, I pray that you would give us the courage to be good citizens in our country day by day, but you'll also give us the courage to be compassionate, to find ways that we can be a blessing to someone in a more vulnerable situation than we may be in ourselves. Help us, Lord, to give of our resources that others may find hope, because you have emptied yourself of everything, all the riches of heaven, everything but love, in order to bring us the riches of eternity that can never be taken away from us. Father, we pray that you would be with our leaders at the local, state, national, and global level, that you will give them wisdom and understanding. We pray for doctors and nurses, others on the front lines of this pandemic, that you will protect their health, that you will protect their ability to have open hearts towards those that they are caring for. Equip all of us with the challenges of this hour, Lord. You have brought us for such a time as this, and we can trust you with it as we look to you. You who taught us to pray together, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Friends, as we get ready to close, I want to share these words from a praise song that we'll be learning shortly, but haven't done it yet. It comes from the song, "Yet Not I, But Through Christ in Me." The night is dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior, he will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need his power is displayed. To this I hold, my Savior will defend me. Through the deepest valley he will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. And so, let us go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Return no one evil for evil, but strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor everyone. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Amen.